planning meeting.
Strategic planning meeting. At the conclusion of that meeting, a recommendation was made to Gino that we, I think it was me that made the recommendation, that we create a steering committee for CCP comprised of a couple of board members from this board who could work with CCP when they have strategic business issues that need our input. And I thought that if we had a defined committee of this board, that a new committee who could help understand what we're doing and where we're going, and then come to the full board and bring business issues, business decisions that need to be made in a timely manner. And I think with some additions to our board, we now have some additional people, and I think we have some resources and people with some experiences. And I think it would be helpful to Gino in working with CCP to further that relationship and continue to help them grow that business long term. So my recommendation would be that the chair create a committee, steering committee for CCP, staff it with a couple of board members who could really dig down deep into the proposals, work with them, obviously, through their open board meetings with our joint venture partner, come back and make recommendations to the board for things that they want to do and that we should either propose to participate or vote for or against. But in fairness to the joint partnership, I think it would be more effective use of our time and more effective use of our partnership to help them grow the business. So that was my recommendation.
Just a clarification, it would be a special committee under the bylaws.
I'm not sure how it fits in the bylaws, and I guess that would be for you and that chair to figure out a special committee.
It's called a special committee, and it is created at the discretion of the chair, who appoints the members who would have to agree, and then the scope would be whatever the board decides to provide to that committee, and then when the scope is done, whatever the board decides, the committee is dissolved.
Yep, I'm good with that.
If it's a special committee, it's time limited based on...
It is purpose limited.
Purpose limited.
Right, so the board could say time limited, but it's purpose limited, so whatever the board delegates to the special committee, when that purpose is over, whenever that would be, then the board, the committee would be dissolved.
Otherwise, the other alternative for a steering committee would have to be one board member.
One board member, if you wanted to, you would have been talking almost all of this in the public, unless you go have a strategic issue, which is an enumerated list of items,
yeah,
including expanding a service, et cetera. It's not just what one would commonly think of as strategic.
I like the idea of a special committee because you could comprise of a couple of members who obviously would have to, wouldn't communicate outside of an open meeting, but at least you've got two minds or three minds working on the proposals. And I think, you know, when you hear something or read something and two people are going to have different perceptions of what you read and what you heard, I think it helps in discussing that with the full board. And I think, you know, a purpose committee, special committee may be appropriate. I don't think we have to put a time limit on it, right?
You do not.
Time limit could be when CCP...
It's
no
whenever
longer
the board decides the committee's role is done, has been accomplished, or is no longer needed.
Right.
Does this accomplish the speed goal that you want? The idea behind this, I thought, was to make things happen quicker. Does this structure do that? Because you'll have to announce a meeting with the other group at that time.
Well,
not
with the other group. It could be just with this group
initially.
It would still be announced.
Still to the process.
Correct.
So within 30 days, I mean, the timing of that all has to be pretty tight. So do you think it meets what you're trying to get done?
I think it's 100% better than where we are now. And I think if we find that it's not effective, it's a temporary committee, we can disband it and go back to what we're doing. I think it's worth an opportunity to do it. And I think there's, you know, I think a solid business reason why we should be doing this. And I think a little bit of focus on the board, I think would be good for, you know, we're a 50-50 joint venture partner, so why wouldn't we want to have, you know, a committee that could act in a judicious manner to evaluate and bring proposals or ideas or things to the board.
Is the CCP
as a partner, the district has one vote, right? So the president and CEO makes the vote. I think, and it's not an authority issue. We have the authority to do it. I think what it is we're looking for a guidance issue, and I believe that I do agree it's 100% better than what we had. I think what we're looking for, because there's not that many large decisions we need to make that are complex. I think once we start working through them, we'll find that we don't need to have as many of those meetings. But I think if we had that special committee and the board members got a good understanding and had a comfort level one way or the other, because where we're at and the juxtaposition is that there's operationally we all agree we want to do the same thing. It's how to get there that seems to be problematic. So I think what we would need is to have the committee and some counsel of some sort, internally or externally or both, to be able to do some work and vetting and then present it to that special committee, both sides, so that the committee had an understanding. Because there's two sides to the story, I guess, is what I'm getting at. And I think we need to put both sides on the table and have it flushed out in that steering committee.
All right, so you're not, the intent of this is not to have this committee attend the CCP meetings?
No. So the issue would be that the CCP is made up of the two members, which is President Beth Capasso and Aurelio. Those are not the meetings that they're talking about. It's for two or however many board members to understand a lot of the details of where there might not be a meeting of the minds on how to get where they want to go. And the committee would then get into the details, not operationally, from a policy perspective. Where does the entity want to go? Strategy is the board's, is in the board's purview, clearly in the charter. So that subcommittee, if you will, or special committee would help set the policy to give direction to senior management and do it more quickly to be able to go back to CCP at maybe one of their board meetings with the members. Operationally, you know, details.
From what I know about CCP, it's been very successful in a very short period of time. The delays in moving on something is what I thought was the major issue. And as long as this does that, I think we should move forward pretty quickly to help the North and the South both benefit from this. But in the end, that council will go to bed to make that decision.
Within the parameters of the board guidance. So the policy on how to go and how to do things is in the purview of the board.
So this doesn't impede her, right? This helps her move this along.
Yeah, no, I think it's additive to Bev and to Gino when they're evaluating something that needs to be evaluated with respect to the CCP. Because in the past, we had to do a special board meeting, or we have to try to make it when everybody's here, get them in here, do a presentation. It's just not an effective way for us to get really get a good deep understanding of the business proposal or whatever the issue is. I think this would allow a subcommittee of the board to really deep dig down, give guidance, help out, and then come and educate the board and decide if the board wants to recommend something. I just think it would speed the process and get us to a better result.
I would agree. I just think it's a complex product that is risk, some risk involved, and so we need to get a quick education.
I do want to say it would be problematic. Introducing two board members on it, the only concern we have is there's a lot of items we're going to be discussing that have to do not only with strategy, but also legality of the structure. That's the only downside to that.
And you talked about outside counsel or something. Does CCP have?
So CCP has counsel, and Memorial has their counsel. We have our counsel. I think part of the issue has been, operationally we all agree what we want to do, right? I think what it comes down to is how do we structure it best so that it's legal and with as low risk as possible. Am I saying that about right, Lynn? And so I think that's where there's two schools of thought. And what we're looking for is some direction on, here's what we're comfortable, here's the level of risk we're comfortable with, here's what we agree with. And that's the answer we want to provide. That's what we need to be nimble on.
So this this is all a presumption that the joint partnership is going to continue. It's going to stay the way it is, and we're going to try to make it more successful.
Yes.
So you have three attorneys involved?
Well, you
right.
Two out of three?
One attorney for you. And
yes,
so that would be what we would be doing in these meetings.
Well, we have one, the South has one, and then CCP has one.
Correct.
There's a few attorneys here. I rarely see attorneys agree, that many attorneys agree, but two out of three might agree. Is that enough?
It depends which two agree.
Well, listen, I support it wholeheartedly. I think CCP is a great product and can do very well for us. I think anything that you can do to speed up the process is good. Opportunities go really quick. And if they pass, they pass. And
yes.
We're not just talking about ourselves. We're hurting them. We're hurting the South. They, you know, we are more organized than we were, it appears to me, than a year ago, than actually even 6 months ago. So we should be able to move a little quicker and meet their sense of urgency as well. So I support it. I think it's a great idea. Hopefully we can get to it.
Well, it seems the only issue is whether we appoint the special committee to have two commissioners or one, because having two would slow down the speed with which the committee can operate. Whereas one would be able to consult more readily.
Why would it slow it down? I'm just curious.
We have to do the notice, and then it has to be in the public. And then I'm going to have to figure out if we're going to partner with a facility. I need to figure out a way to pitch the plan without saying which facility it is.
It still has to come to the public anyway.
Eventually, yeah.
If you're one board member, it eventually will come to the board. So if you align
that special committee with an outside counsel or inside counsel, and then
the special committee would be, for example, two people, which is a lot easier than having five people, and it's a 7-day notice.
I think that with two people, whoever the two people are to ultimately decide that they accept this role, I think they'll accept it on understanding that whoever it is, we'll make ourselves available to make this work. I think two minds really is better than one. That's just my opinion on this, but I could be wrong. There may be scenarios where one person may not be available, but the other is, and they need, you know, it just, I don't know.
You can't have a special committee of one, so that's kind of settled, right?
Right.
So it seems at this point we formed the special committee. Hopefully the special committee would be able to achieve its purpose and act speedily, more so than the full board would be able to, certainly. And with the understanding that, of course, the special committee would report back to the board as other committees do, and as further direction is needed, but that the board would give a certain scope to the special committee directing its authority. So the question now is, do we need to identify that scope? Now, I'm willing to create the special committee. The question is, do we need to come out with the scope right now? I think it seems that we would want to, because the scope would need to be voted on by the board.
Correct.
So I don't know if I by just acclamation say I'm creating a special committee for the purpose of providing guidance relative to the community care partnership issue.
And evaluating proposals brought to the committee by senior management for recommendation or not, or information to the board as a matter of policy.
Okay.
I second that.
Good, because I can't repeat it.
That's not the name of the committee.
I think it is.
Okay, I was trying to be brief. Okay, so that committee is now created.
CCP special committee, or whatever you want to call it.
Well, I think I created.
Oh, you
created.
Yeah, you created.
Okay, so we've now created the Community Care Partnership Special Committee. The next question is either scope or commissioners to participate.
Oh, I'm sorry, I gave you the scope. That wasn't the name of the committee. That was the scope.
Okay, so that was the proposed scope.
That was the proposed scope.
Can we ask?
John, Pence, does this help resolve? Would this help resolve any issues?
I agree with Gino. Anything's worth a try.
Okay. So, is there a motion to authorize the committee just so formed with the scope as described by General Counsel?
I move a motion that happens.
Are we clear on what the scope is?
Yes.
Okay, is there any further discussion on the motion? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries, the committee's formed, it has its scope. The question now is, which commissioners wish to participate on the committee? Okay, Commissioners Berry and Commissioner Well. Okay. Committee ratification of that appointment to the committee? Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. The next item is the, was added relative to the HR, as referred by the HR committee relative to the tier two plan for fiscal 18. Commissioner Wells?
Yes, this was actually recommended to be on the discussion agenda. I'm not sure how we missed it, but Peter, you have the two motions that we passed? If not, I can read them for you.
Yes, I do.
Okay.
So it was slightly adjusted. The motion that HR committee recommends to the board to add additional criteria to be met for the second payment under the 2018 fiscal year incentive compensation plan to include the submission of the annual report required under the CIA in order to release the balance of the incentive compensation payment for the tier two employees.
That's the second part, and I think what's missing there is we discussed that it had to be submitted on time and the audited financials.
Correct, and okay. Then it continues. Employee being eligible due to length of service, continuous employment for 6 months and a day or longer, any full calendar month beyond 6 months and a day would be paid on a prorated basis. That was in addition. Eligibility would also be subject to any existing policy Broward Health may have related to exemptions. The employee must be employed at the time of payment being made and have had no disciplinary issues. So that was added to the recommendation.
And this would cover all tier two employees only?
That is correct.
And that's fiscal year 18?
For fiscal year 18, and these are your frontline leaders, not the most senior leaders.
Correct, and this would be only paid if we met the financial objectives that were discussed.
For the current fiscal year.
And the submission to the CIA and the second half.
For the second payment.
Okay, correct. So you're gonna walk through the payment schedule as the proposed payment schedule, so everybody understands?
Absolutely. Once the financial trigger has been met, the first payment will be paid once the initial financials are submitted. These are your
accepted by the board. Second payment comes in the audited.
Correct.
So we have to submit them. Correct. We have to accept them. And then when the audit's complete is when the trigger.
Absolutely. And then the second trigger is that the audited financials are done and the CIA
is submitted on time. And I think we made provisions for a force majeure
right.
In the event we had a hurricane and we got an extension from the OIG that we wouldn't penalize. As long as that's the audited financials are done from the auditors,
yes.
Accepted by the board, and the CIA has been submitted on time.
Correct.
Whatever that time frame is, if there's an extension due to a hurricane, it is.
Yes.
As long as it's on time, then those tier two employees would get the second half of the payment.
Yes, that okay. Is correct.
I go back to my issue on this. I believe the CIA should be a disqualifying event, not the reason for the bonus. It should be the reason you don't get a bonus. There shouldn't be the second tier you're talking about. First, the financials, the money out of operations. I have a problem with the 6 month length of time. How long is somebody, how long is it before somebody's permanent? Is there a 90-day review period?
For this group, there is no, everyone is
so they're immediately
will.
Vested?
That is correct. They're at will. So if anything were to be, you're on probation.
So it's 6 months.
Correct.
Again, they have to start before December 31st in order to qualify for the one for this year.
Yes.
We're talking about this year. We're talking about 30 days from now.
Correct.
So there's a lot of people who already think they're going to get this. I think the 6 months is short, but I would take that. I have a lot of heartburn over the CIA issue. I think that you're talking about really senior management here, right?
No, this,
I know it's not senior management. Oh. These are leaders in the organization.
Correct.
These are all people who have to help get us where we want to go. You guys alone aren't going to get the CIA done and all the compliance. You need this team. So this team, there should be I don't want to call it a punitive measure, but I think that is the base. You do not get that done, all bets are off. You're talking about giving bonuses from a losing operation. In the for-profit world, that would never happen. You would not give bonuses to anybody if you lost money. I mean, maybe you would on a contractual basis. So that's kind of where my heartburn is. I'm okay with doing that to some degree, as Alan talked about. It's profit out of operations or money out of operations,
yes.
And it's not coming out of the tax ad valorem and stuff underneath. But I think you need to have a disqualifying event. I think the CIA needs to be serious. We're 2 years behind, from what I understand, right? That's just not acceptable. It's a five-year plan for a reason. It takes a long time to turn a ship like this. I have confidence that this team will do it, but you're 2 years behind. No, to no fault of your own, you're 2 years behind. So I think people need to understand how serious this is. I believe you guys do. But I think you need to understand how serious this is. That CIA has to be complied with. Timeliness is a simple thing to ask for.
Yes.
I didn't even say anything about quality of it. I just getting it in on time. And I think that has to be there has to be a trigger with that.
But isn't the effect the same? You get it if it's timely, you don't get it if it's not timely.
You get the first half. So really the if it turned out to not be timely, then the second half would not be given. So
they only get
that's
half the payment in that case.
Correct.
So it would be a pro rata portion of it for tier two.
I get it, but think about what we did to the physicians earlier. A 95% pass rate for them to do the coding right, for the coding to be right, right? If they don't do that, there were 8 other measures that they would lose a percentage, I think 17.5% or 12.5% for each measure. If they don't do the 95% pass rate, they get nothing. It doesn't matter how good they did in the other 7. Why is there a different standard for the executives? If the physicians are, if there's something that important, which coding is critical, if there's something that important that we're looking at there, why wouldn't we also look at that with the executives?
So you're saying give none of the bonus until the CIA is timely.
Yes. And they will not, nobody will get a bonus if we don't get the CIA timely. That's what I'm suggesting.
I thought that was part of the motion.
I'm a little bit confused because we use CIA and the annual report. I'm assuming you're talking about the annual report.
No, I'm talking about the CIA. I'm talking about the corporate integrity agreement,
yeah,
right?
The annual report submitted as a result of the CIA.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. So we did discuss this at
but that's what we just said.
We did discuss this at Brinkley, and I want to make sure, because I think I'm agreeing with you, but I'm not sure how this differs from what you're saying. When we debated this at length the last, the concern was having any either real or perceived lack of transparency, lack of forthcomingness from anybody within the chain of command that either maybe is a certifying party or not. I don't, I'm not
right.
Sure. But we don't want to discourage people from bringing issues, exceptions, and so on. So if I'm understanding you correctly, Commissioner Berry, it's the timely submission of the annual report, right?
Yes.
It may have exceptions, it may not have exceptions, there may be issues, there may not be issues, but what we don't want to do is improperly incentivize people not bring issues. And I think that would be very frowned upon by Laura Ellis' office, and I know we debated this at great length. So
I think I know what the disconnect is.
Okay. Thank you, because I'm not sure what I'm not understanding.
You're all saying the same thing. The difference is, and Commissioner Berry is bringing up, is that half of that payment comes before the submission, and here's why that happened from last time. The timing of everything, so the Our year end is July. That was supposed to trigger the first 50% of the 17.5%. We didn't want to wait until October, which is when we think the annual submission would be done, plus the audited financial statements, to have a payment, because they've been waiting for 3 years. So we said do half now, half after that. So I think since you're all saying the same thing, there's only two options. Either one, you say that since we submitted on time for this section, that affects the first half, or we say no payment until, let's call it October, whenever the second one is. Because you're saying the same thing, it's just a matter of timing.
And we did. We discussed that at length.
Yeah. And I think several conversations related around the CIA, and I know I was one of you who brought that up. I think the opinion was that these are the individuals that are sort of day-to-day running departments, nursing leaders, hadn't had a bonus structure in place. This was a compromise we came to. It's not a perfect compromise, but it's really a stopgap measure for 1 year. It's this year only. We've been talking to, this has been talked about for several months now. So the thought process was, okay, we pay them half of it at the financials, if we achieve the financial target, but if we don't achieve the other target, that getting that CIA done in time, then they don't get the second half of it. It's not perfect. I think it's where we were, and you weren't here at the time. I wish you were, because your input earlier was really helpful with your knowledge. But this does not affect Tier 1 employees, which would be the senior certifying employees. This is just the larger group of people who are certifying but don't have the same responsibility level to the CIA compliance. I would have liked to be that way, but I think this was a compromise we came with. So,
we also talked about the salaries, that their salaries are not up to scale, and that this goes to some extent to bring their salaries up to where they should be. It's not a reward for perfect performance. It's the best compromise we can come up with to bring both factors into the mix and yet give these people who've been waiting so long something.
Absolutely. And we really didn't have a callback capability here, because this is something was a stopgap measure for this year to reward the employees for kind of the hard work that's been done in the facilities to try to reorganize. There's been a lot of change in leadership, so they've had to, these people have stuck with us, and a lot of them are working with us. So that's where we were with it.
Right, 25% are actually your nursing leaders.
25% of the tier two.
20, correct. So you're talking really frontline leaders, nurse managers.
Not the executive team.
Not correct.
Executive team members.
Okay. I just want to separate the language. They don't want it to look like we're bonusing anybody for just submitting the way it read was like submitting. It didn't even say timely submission. It didn't say anything.
Right.
In that first tier one, but we're going to workshop that. So we're talking about tier two. We're talking about people much closer to the service. I'm fine with that. When will that the first bonus happen? I thought you said after audit at one point.
No, if it as proposed at the July board meeting of the interim financials for 6:30, we would pay out 50% to tier two. Once the board accepts those, and then the audit will be already in process, I believe.
The audit will just start, yeah. But we think that the timing of the timely submission of the annual report and the audit should be within a board meeting of each other, if not the same board meeting. So we talked at length at the last board meeting that nothing really is changing per se, it's just we added additional language because it's the final annual report is important to this organization.
Yeah, and I think the motion should definitely specify that it's a timely acceptance, a submission of the CIA annual report, which is what we passed out of committee. I think for some reason it's just not in the motion.
Maybe he can change, there's qualifications for eligibility. Maybe he can just separate, because there's very clear delineations between eligibility and disqualification. So eligibility would be you're here for 6 months. Disqualification would be a non-timely submission of the annual report. Maybe that would make it a little bit more clear, memorialized anyway.
Unless you want to bring this back to the June meeting and just have the motion nailed down.
I'm okay now.
if we workshop quickly, the tier one folks, the tier one folks are really the ones who have to get this done.
Right.
In my opinion.
Yeah, but this is not going to address that.
I get it. It's only addressing the tier twos, so I'm okay with it. Just it's a stopgap measure. We won't have this next year.
Correct.
The other concern, as I said, was there's nothing in here about QA scores. There's nothing here about price gaining, about client satisfaction. And you've got to have measures outside of finance, losing finance. There has to be something that's positive. If press gaining scores are 50 and you can get them up to 60 next year, I'd be thrilled. 70 the next year, I'd be thrilled. I'm not talking about turning anything over tonight, but having a reasonable, rational way of getting to where everybody else is and to perform as well as we possibly can and getting our numbers up. I get that this is a stopgap measure, but hopefully we'll quickly get to where we are looking at all the measures that you should be looking at this level.
Yeah, I think that was definitely the intent of the balance scorecard. We just need to have something.
And that would encompass everything going forward from July 1st, tier one and tier two, such that it
will place
for 2019. I think Commissioner Berry's input on helping us craft what's in that balance scorecard, what are the measures that are appropriate, the metrics is where that discussion earlier. So I think it was irrelevant here because this really started about 6 months into the year. So we couldn't get there.
And it was never the intent for this to appear to be a reward for submitting the report. It was where that came in was just strictly with the timing of the payments.
So just to summarize here, I mean, we're talking about the criteria for the payment of the second half of the incentive payment.
Correct.
And there are two criteria, as I understand it. One is the timely submission of the annual report under the CIA, under the corporate integrity agreement, and two is acceptance by the board of the audited financials for fiscal year 18.
Correct. Second half could not be paid until those two things were done.
Yes.
In a timely fashion. The audit, obviously, it is when the auditor is finished, but the submission to the CIA has a defined date that has to be met.
I believe that's November 1st.
So,
unless
it's
granted
an extension, whatever the first
or
third.
Okay, so timely submission is certainly one of the two criteria. Okay.
Is it
granted?
It's the third.
From
the cheap seats in the back.
Now, there is one other item associated with this, and we may want to address this at the same time, and this was discussed earlier, which is this fire plan that seems to be lingering out there, yet unfunded. And it seems to me, prior to conclusively adopting a new incentive plan, we need to put to rest any prior plans to make sure we're not creating exposure under the prior plan and the current plan. I don't know if this is something that got through HR committee at all, or what the status of these current plans, the old plan is, but to the extent it creates an exposure or liability for the system, I think we need to terminate whatever that prior incentive plan may have been.
That was why I was asking the question in HR, and what I was told at least by our council was there is no prior plan. It was something done on an annual basis, which was different than what I understood, but
right.
The board can pass a resolution to just define any prior plan is no longer in existence.
Go forward with the plan that we're developing, correct.
Does that solve the problem?
Yes.
Okay. So maybe we should do that first.
Don't you think we should get the plan, like the workshop, and then do all of that?
No.
This is just for the stopgap part.
So let me withdraw my motion. Let's deal with that first.
Okay. Motion withdrawn. Motion relative to prior plans.
I make a motion that the board formally eliminates any prior incentive compensation plans that existed at Broward Health prior to fiscal year 17-18. And any plans that are currently in existence for 17-18 are no longer valid as of the start of this year.
Okay, motion's been made and seconded.
Well, I just want to make sure that's going to pass from a legal standpoint, everything we need to say.
I mean, when I got here, there were no plans. So there was no plan last year, and there was no
want to make sure that it's clear that there is no.
I heard it wasn't planned, it just wasn't funded.
May have existed, theoretically existed, funded or unfunded, in theory, in concept or in practice.
Well said.
And I have a question. If the word plan, this would not impact any contractual rights.
Okay, I think that's a wise point. Is there any discussion on that motion that is now made and seconded? All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries. Next motion.
I make a motion that the board accepts the HR committee's recommendation for tier two employees incentive compensation plan for the fiscal year 17-18 that includes a 50% payment to tier two employees only at the acceptance of the board financial statements, and that the second half of the payment is not paid until a timely submission of the CIA and the audited financials have been accepted by the board, subject to the employee being eligible due to length of service, continuous employment for 6 months and a day or longer. Any full calendar month beyond 6 months of the day would be paid on a prorated basis. Eligibility would also be subject to any existing policy Broward Health may have related to exemptions. Employee must be employed at the time of the payment being made and have no disciplinary issues to the extent that it's not otherwise covered in another policy. For the year fiscal year 17.
Second.
Okay, motions are made and seconded. Is there further discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Is there anything further on that item relative to the tier two employee incentive plan?
Contracts here. at Broward Health. One is for contracts that the board initiates based on positions that need sort of a ratification of the board. And those positions are positions like the CEO, the regional CEOs of the hospitals, the chief compliance officer, president, and CEO is separate really from that specific process, because the president and CEO process is defined by what the board sets up. But what's in the bylaws, I put down on paper in front of you. So the board requests employment contract. So in when that is the case, once a verbal offer, we generally deal with a particular individual, and once they accept the verbal offer, the contract template is provided by general counsel. HR reviews and inputs the negotiated terms into the contract template, and then general counsel or their designee reviews the final contract and approves. The board designated member for the hiring process presents the contract to the board, and upon approval by the board, the chairman and the candidates would then execute the contract. So that's how any position that deals directly with the board would be handled. Yes.
And I apologize, Peter, I didn't see this before.
Sure.
The template is actually done by HR. And historically, HR has done the contracts for the CEOs and for the general counsel. So we got it actually from HR, Vince Cologne. I checked when I saw this. So we don't have that in our forms. That's something typically HR did directly with the board in the past.
Right. But not as I know it, because
not
as I know it, or I've been involved with Glenn. As far as I know, the process, I would come to you for the template that we've used.
Yeah, no, we had to go to HR. So Legal Denver did the contracts for the CEO. I'm not sure why. It was always done by HR for, as I understand it, Mr. Nask and definitely Dr. Elsinore. So that's the template was developed. I don't know who developed the template. It was before my time. I'm assuming it was.
You review every contract.
Not this particular one. I didn't approve this particular the CEO's contract. We had outside counsel review it on the day-to-day issues.
Right. My understanding is we're talking about the process, not
correct.
The specific contract.
That is correct.
But I don't know that I would review it, Nick's contract or internal audit. We've never had them. So we're only talking about one contract and my contract, and I certainly wouldn't review my own contract, nor would somebody who report to me review it. That would be somebody designated by the board to negotiate. I could get my own lawyer if I wanted to.
Are we only talking about this first part, right?
Right.
That is correct.
Correct.
That's a non-board report.
No, it says board requests.
Right.
Board requests.
Those are board requests.
That's the board report.
Correct.
So right now there are two.
So those
could be four. There's two by the bylaws, right? The
charter doesn't say there's a contract or not. The practice was that the CEO would get a contract. When I got here, I got a contract. There was discussion in 2015-16, and I think Commissioner, you were here, that anybody who reports to the board should be on contract. So that at that time would have included internal audit. For some reason that was never done. And then when the chief compliance officer was made a board report, that position could or would have a contract depending on board policy. It's not dictated by the charter that you have to have a contract.
But there are two people that this board is responsible for.
Four people.
Two and then the other two, yes. But two that have contracts.
Two that have contracts and two that don't.
So the board requests this. You're talking about a template. Who developed the template? Because I've read the contract and I've read previous ones as well. And when was that developed? I mean, are you using the same contract?
using the same contract, and for any contract that I've been involved in, which I guess would be BEVS, I got that template from General Counsel.
But you get that. You develop who's going to be a report to BEV, and then you give it to legal, and then legal gives it to the board. That's how this works. That may not be how it works, but the process now says you'll get it, or you'll develop it, you'll sort of negotiate it, you give it to BEV to negotiate, then it comes to the board?
A board member is designated by the board to negotiate the contract.
It's the second to last.
Right.
All this other work is done before that board person gets involved. It says General Counsel, their designee, reviews the final contract. The final contract and approves, and then it goes to the board designated person for hiring process. Is that right?
That's not the way it was done before. So the way it was done for my contract, for example, and I had a contract that was not the form. I got the form initially, which was like the contracts that other senior management have. And then it was decided that I would get this other form. But the way it worked is I never worked directly with HR. You know, HR didn't negotiate my contract. It was a board member that would negotiate with me.
Absolutely.
This is where I'm getting confused. Okay. I don't really care about a contract for you, Lynn, in 2015. I want to understand what the process is that we are employing either now, currently, or what we are going to change, approve, or otherwise demand going forward. If somebody didn't follow, I wasn't here when you were hired. If somebody didn't follow some process, there was a lot of things that weren't done according to process before I got here.
Right.
Okay. My understanding is we're talking about a process that is either in existence today.
Yes.
Or will be approved and will be the go forward process. Not about history.
Correct. Change history. Correct. Right? So the way really it works is once the selected individual has been selected and the board assigns a board designee to the task of negotiation. Right now it's, at least based on past practice, it's the secretary treasurer who would have that assignment for a board report, at least as far as I've seen from the minutes in the past. That individual would work with me. As head of HR, I would get the template because obviously they don't have it from General Counsel.
I'm assuming.
Correct.
Your presumption would be that whatever it is you've gotten from General Counsel in terms of a template or an actual
document,
I'm assuming you wouldn't provide Peter with something that you haven't reviewed or otherwise has an issue.
We were asked to provide the template. The General Counsel never had the template. We contacted HR, and we got the template that was used.
It's HR.
Vince Colon gave us the template, and that was Dr. El Sanati's contract, which we were told was the template. We didn't create a template. We didn't develop a template. It was the contract that was used.
I'm not talking about a specific contract. I'm talking about...
But you're asking, you keep saying, did Y review create a template?
What I'm saying is if Peter comes to you and asks for a template.
And we didn't have a template, so we got the template.
Yeah, that's fine. But whatever you provided to Peter, whatever that was, I assume you read it. Did you provide him with something that you...
We provided the requested template, which was, we understood, was the CEO template contract that we got from HR.
Did you read it?
I read a contract before the board, before it came to the board. I did read the contract, yes.
Okay. And so...
And I provided suggestions, but I did not do any negotiating.
I'm not talking about negotiating. I'm trying to understand what we do, because there's legal, it has to work.
With HR.
What I'm hearing you say is you get something from his office. I think it's only natural to assume that's the word kosher with the legal department. That's all I'm trying to understand.
Correct. Okay. And commissioners, that I didn't know the history of the template when I got it. So particular instance. So that's the only example that I have. So we worked together. I obtained the market analysis and did all of that background information and provided it to Commissioner Klein, who was designated as the individual to negotiate the contract, and we made certain adjustments to the contract, and Commissioner Klein had the responsibility of negotiating it, and that's how it worked.
So there's a step before once verbal offer is accepted, and that's some involvement by a board member in negotiating the contract.
That is correct. That is correct. It's I suppose that I should have put in that the designated board member is part of the process really from the beginning, except that I'm the one that was driving getting the information.
I've got some questions I want to ask you.
Sure.
But you want to go. Some of these are yes or no. Let's just run through real quick.
Sure.
Was this contract vetted by the board? Yes or no? But to the best of your knowledge?
It came to the board.
No, the template. Was the template vetted by the board at some point?
That I don't know.
Okay. Was it a standard contract, from your perspective?
Was
standard
it?
Standard form contract for
yes.
The CEO?
Well, yes, correct, yes.
It was, okay. Was there any deviations from the standard contract that you made? And this, I'm only comparing what we did. I don't want to talk about the specifics of it. I want to compare what we did,
right,
what's on here, to what we want to do forward.
There will always be deviations based on the negotiated terms.
Okay, was there any board member made aware or briefed about modifications to the standard language of the contract? Terms, conditions, severance, whatever. Was anybody made aware of changes that were made? One-on-one.
The board member that was assigned to the negotiation process, Commissioner Klein.
All right, so who negotiated the contract then? Was it you or was it
I didn't have that authority to negotiate the contract, so.
So Commissioner Klein negotiated all the terms, the salary, and all that?
That is correct.
Were there any issues that the district, that required the district to make a change or a deviation? Did we raise any issues about the contract that we wanted certain provisions or certain?
I don't understand.
Terms, conditions, severability, any of that issues, severance payments. Did we recommend a severance payment agreement? Or, because those aren't standard, those couldn't be standard plan severance agreements.
Right.
I'm just asking, how did we get to that? Where was, well, was the back and forth?
I think, Commissioner Wellings, really the objective here was to talk about the process, not specific to that degree.
Actually, if you read the minutes, these are exact questions I asked, and they're in the minutes. These are just a little bit drawn out, but they're exactly to the five or six questions that are in the minutes for the April 24th meeting when I asked for this special committee. Okay. I'm not here to go into the minute details of the salary and competition. I'm talking about the process, and
okay,
the reason this is important, because I'm new to this process, the first contract I was involved in. Commissioner Berry's now hasn't been on a contract. Commissioner Gregoire, Commissioner Klein has not. I don't know if Commissioner Geary's ever been. So I think that this contract came to us, and the process, from my perspective, is very unclear how we got here. I want to understand how we get here, so that the next time we negotiate a contract, that we, if we need to adjust or change the way the contract is negotiated, the way the information is brought to the commissioners on briefing one-on-one, who does the back and forth? Is there counsel used inside, outside? I think these are issues that I don't understand, and I want to know.
Absolutely.
I think it's my duty, my responsibility. This has nothing to do with the president and CEO, who I think is doing an excellent job, and this is no way intended to say that she's not doing good. This has nothing to do with Beth. This has to do with the process. I think Beth's doing an excellent
right.
job, and I don't think there's any doubt in any of this board that she's doing a good job, so I don't want this to be personal.
So,
but I do have questions here, and I want answers to them.
Okay. What was the question again, sir?
The question was, What were the main issues that required the district to consider deviating from a standard contract? Was there a, who requested
that,
the changes?
That those are elements of the negotiation, though, Commissioner Welling. So it's part of the process of developing a contract after you look at the fair market value and you're trying to determine what's a fair contract.
So when you came to...
I interacted with Commissioner Klein and we looking at all the information and that's where we ended up.
So when it came to clauses I mentioned, severance, was there a change to severance from the form contract? The length of time, the way the severance is established, is that our form contract? If we went back and looked at the last 3-4 CEOs, were the severance payments the same? The length of time?
They're not. The severance was changed. There are multiple areas in the contract that were changed that are subtle, but they're significant, and that's what you're asking.
Right. I just want to know who raised those issues and who approved them. Should those not have come to the board, is my question.
Right.
And this came to the board. It came to the board 20 minutes before the meeting. This issue, I never want to happen again, because this is going to cost, this potentially, and I don't think it's going to happen, but it could cost us hundreds of thousands of dollars. Okay? And if these were not minor changes, these were major financial changes, I just want to know why no one was briefed ahead of time. We didn't know that they were changed. And so I'm asking the question, how the process works.
I don't believe that any of us understood the process to be any different than what it was that we did.
You're not going to change a lot here, but what one of the things that need to happen is, I already told Beverly, I don't like the current contract form. And when you look at it, a big deal was made about the terminations for certain reasons. I go back to Frank Mass contract. It's exactly the same as what's in Beverly's contract. On moral turpitude, it's exactly the same, which is unfortunate because I wouldn't word this differently. But it is sort of what's been there since as far back as Frank Mass, as far back as I went and looked. It's sort of there, but the changes are subtle. There's the termination, the severance part is different, and then also the responsibility of the board to notify when the annual review is up versus in the other contracts, it was the responsibility of the CEO to tell you when their review was up. It wasn't put on us that if we didn't do it in time, which we should know, there's only two that we have to manage. It's an automatic, it's automatic approval. Automatically she gets the bonuses that she or he, whoever's in that position, gets. My thing on this is I understand the process here. I think the form, we took bad practice from years ago and just perpetuated because nobody stopped to change it. And if you read the contract today, this is not a small job. This is a big job. My big issue with the contracts, there are no metrics in it that say, here's performance, here's what you want. We have one person to manage, and that's Beverly. I don't want to manage Gino. I don't want to manage y'all. I don't want to manage any of them. I want to manage the metrics. And if she's not getting her team to perform, I want to take it out on her. I want to move her or see if she's going to make some improvements. That's what my job is. And this contract does not lend itself, the form contract does not lend itself. I think in Beverly's contract, there's an opportunity in there to still do some of those things. But the form contract does not lend itself to a board managing a CEO the way this board is restricted from managing everybody else. We are allowed to manage the CEO. And this contract does not allow us, really, in my opinion, the current one doesn't allow us to really manage the CEO the way we are charged. And I don't know why it keeps getting perpetuated, why the same agreement from back then. I'd like to see the one who was it, Alan, and then maybe even Will Trower, and see how if it's the same one. Because it seems to me like this is just very, very old. And just like you're saying, there's attorneys sitting here. When a contract is changed and it's presented to me from my team or from a client of mine, there's track changes in it. Very simple, strike through, what are we changing? And then you negotiate those terms. This says 90 days, this one says 60 days. Then you talk to the person, you say, is it 90 days, 60, and you agree. Then you move on, you know the change you made, and everybody agrees to it. That doesn't appear to be done here, and everybody relied. I think what the board is saying is they relied on you and to some degree you, Lynn, and thought that you guys had coordinated this and went along, because I can't imagine that they would have just readily signed this the same night it was presented unless they thought all the I's were dotted and the T's were crossed. Am I getting anywhere near where this
is coming? Unequivocally say I thought what had come to the board was at a minimum vetted legally, and my understanding is you worked very closely with Peter and obviously with Bev, and was there someone outside of the organization also that
outside counsel?
Okay,
yes.
So I mean, the performance aspects, I don't disagree, at least at the time we had already been having the balanced scorecard discussion, so that may be from my, I don't disagree. I've managed people, and if you don't measure it, it's very difficult to manage to it, so I totally agree. I relied on the balanced scorecard approach, but as far as what came to the board, outside of certain key, more salient issues like salary and so on, at least I was under the impression that it had gone through certain steps with general counsel's office, outside counsel, of course, Commissioner Klein is quite capable, your input and assistance, but ultimately it's two people having to agree also, or two, well, a person and a body, right?
Right, so that's absolutely right. And the contract in reference does point to the management incentive plan that we knew at the time was we were going to discuss and was being developed. So that's where the metrics would come in.
What was the role of the outside counsel?
I'm happy to address a little bit of this, because Chairman Rodriguez had asked me to take the lead role in the contract negotiation, and I obtained, from, I think it was directly from Peter, what I understood was our standard contract for direct reports to the board. And I think I had a discussion with Lynn as well, and he said, I think you said this contract was a better form than yours was. This was a good form for a contract. Then I suggested before it being brought to the board that we run it by outside counsel. And outside counsel looked at the agreement and confirmed that it was a good employment agreement. I think made two minor changes, which were accepted, and then it was presented to the board. I think that the shortcoming in the entire process is a shortcoming of the procedures of this board previously, which is a lot of things being very last minute. And that's one of the things that I've asked the executive team to change going forward, which is that we have deadlines for items to be presented before the board, for agendas to be set a week in advance, and for items to be circulated to the board members for consideration well prior to the board meeting, because as a board member who'd been on the board only for several months, even now, I think maybe 9 months or so, 8 months or 8 or 9 months, it seemed like a lot of things are presented to the board members as we sit down for the board meetings. And that, to me, as chairman, is not an acceptable way to proceed. And I've asked the executive team to set firm deadlines together with Patricia for, again, the setting of agendas, so that agendas are established well in advance and then noticed to the public in advance, and that items are circulated so that there's time for due consideration by each of the board members separately and independently, obviously, before we actually get here and need to vote on those things. And I don't know that process was really well followed here, because as Commissioner Wells indicated, the contract was circulated, I think, to the board members that day of the board meeting.
And the concern, I'm sorry.
So I think going forward, that's certainly something that we need to focus on. I think that in addition to all of that, the board needs to ensure that it has the resources available to it independently of the executive team. Because the executive team is obviously the executive team, but as an executive board, I think that we have an obligation ourselves and a duty of care, and we need to think about resources that are going to be available to us to help us fulfill our role, not simply just kind of a reaching out to a labor lawyer at the last minute for a contract review, but knowing that we have resources available to us for those independent reviews. And that's something I had planned to bring up at a future board meeting, because I think that it's just an important measure of independence as well. I mean, obviously not at all a criticism of the executive team, but just a measure of where the board has its own responsibility and its own duty of care to know that it's fulfilling that role. So that, I don't know if that helps with that.
I lay a lot of the blame for the inconsistencies in what we understand on ours. This was, listen, we should have had more information. This process, I see at least three more steps in this process that are missing.
Okay.
And I think they're huge steps. I think step one is contract needs to be provided that's been vetted by the board in a new form. I said step two, during those contract negotiations, as any material changes were to be made to a contract, I think there needs to be a step in the middle where each board member needs to be briefed individually on what those material changes are, because we can't brief us as a group, so we have to brief us individually. That didn't occur. So the back and forth, what the candidate's asking for, what we're asking for, if they're material, those changes should have come before the board. I think the board designee should play an active role, and I'm guessing that Commissioner Klein took an active role in that. I don't doubt that, and this is not a criticism of him, but he needs to take it as a role. But the rest of us should know what's going on also on an individual basis. I think the contract, if it goes to an outside counsel, should go to the outside counsel in time for the outside counsel to actually have a time to review it. I don't know how much time this outside counsel had to review this contract. Was it 1 day? Was it 2 days? Was it a week? Was it a month? Were they involved from the beginning to the end? If we're going to use counsel outside, that person should be involved in the process from day one. And whatever changes that our outside counsel is requesting, we should be briefed on. Because if they're material, we're responsible for understanding that and accepting it. And that contract should be presented to the board 30 days prior to a vote. We should have time to read it, understand it. It should come to us through the board meeting before it's approved in the future. I think this is the only way you get to a process where there's discipline, where there's no variations, where there's complete information, there's complete transparency. And again, I want to state it for the record, this has nothing to do with Bev. Bev, unfortunately, is sitting in the seat, and she's the person who we're reviewing the process. It's unfortunate because it shouldn't be. And I want to make that very clear. I have no issue with Bev. I don't have an issue with her salary. I think the salary is in line with where I expected it to be, within $25,000 or whatever it is. I think it's in line. I think the portion of it that was spelled out, the incentive compensation, the 20% number, it's not the way I recommended to you, it's not what I suggested to you, but I don't think it's totally off the wall. It's the lack of information that we had and the things that we discovered after the fact that we're saying, hey, this was not the process we should follow. There's other issues in there, and it has to do with, the material changes, which puts district on the hook for tons and tons of money. I hope we never have to pay it. I hope Bev is here to the last very possible day, because I think she's earned the right to do that. But the process wasn't done in a way that's flawed. I'm not making this up. I think I'm not the only one that's recognized this. I got a letter from the governor, which all of us got. He clearly recognized it. He thought it was important for us to review this. And that's why I asked for this to go. So I think, again, another workshop should be held prior to us even entering in the negotiations for the next contract. And I think we have one coming up later this year, where we nail this process down, that where it's hard and fast and it's set, and there's a timeline for how this occurs. I think it's an equally important step that needs to be done. This review needs to be done, and I think it's a productive review for us going forward. That's all I'm getting at here. And I know that's probably not what everybody believes, but that's 100% what I believe. It's my responsibility as a board member to protect the integrity of this organization. And every time we do something where we don't follow processes, when we get in trouble. That's been the history of here, and I'm trying to say, as long as I'm on this board and I'm here for another 4 years or whatever it is, we are going to instill process and discipline to everything we do from the board's perspective. I can't control what happens in the field. I can only control what our role is. And our role is going to be process and discipline for the people that report to us. And that's got to be driven down the organization. So that's why we're here. It's not a critique of you. It's not a critique of Bev. It's a critique of the process in which I think collectively we all failed. We got there to the right number, I believe, and we got there to the right person. We just didn't get there in the right manner. That was one.
Which contract do you think we have to renegotiate this year?
I think we have one. Don't we have one contract coming up? Is it your contract up in July?
No.
No?
Her contract auto-renewed about a month ago.
Okay, so then we don't have any to do now. So we should work on this over the summer. We should nail this process down.
I think we should address the governor's letter a little bit, too.
Sure.
I don't think that Beverly has an issue with the four items or five items that he thought should have been in the contract. And I actually think, and there's a portion of that, I don't have it in front of me, but that allows a 20% bonus based on something along those lines. When we workshop the other issue, can we take half a couple hours to workshop those issues too? So we need to negotiate with her in good faith those issues, those performance issues that will trigger that bonus. I'm pretty sure there's something that said that. I can't, there is something.
There is, I have it. And this gets to the heart of why I'm concerned about this is that in her contract has a bonus. It spells out compliance with the CIA, but it doesn't establish what the metrics are. It's not fair to her to not know what she's being measured on.
But it allows the board to negotiate those with her, doesn't it?
That's the way. So just a clarification, it's not compliance with the CIA.
It's
significant improvement in the compliance program.
Yeah, okay,
and
so.
The board would determine what that means, just like they would do it in my contract.
Well, we need to tell her what that is. We need to sit down with Bev and say, Bev, this is what we expect as a board. Because how else is she able to fulfill her obligation and achieve the maximum compensation that she's entitled to unless she knows what we're measuring her against?
But that's why I'm suggesting we workshop that portion of it. Whatever there is that the board has to agree with her, we need to get to it pretty quickly. And I don't think the governor's four or five issues are burdensome at all. And I think you guys are already well into looking at those even bigger. Just boiling them down to four or five. The projected, that scorecard I saw, the one you have, Gino, very extensive. I mean, there's a ton of information on there. It'll be easy to get the four or five items addressed. And I think, I couldn't imagine that Beverly wouldn't agree to the things she probably agreed to a million other times. But I do think that needs to happen. And I also agree we need a different core contract. I have no issues with Lynn, but her contract should not have auto-renewed without us dealing with it. Not me, because obviously I wasn't here, but in the future, and it does come up in 2 years, I'm going to put it on my day timer, the old school day timer. I'm going to put it in my phone so that we know to negotiate when it does. Her contract's 38 pages or 32 pages. It's ridiculous. It's just, it's long, but no contracts in this company should auto-renew without somebody, your level, our level, looking at it and saying, do we still want to do this?
Because Lynn's contract, I haven't seen it, but I assume it's not a standard contract. It's not what we're using. And again, consistency across the organization is what we're getting at. So our direct reports should all have basically the same contract. There may be some minor adjustments to the CEO or the general counsel, but they should read and look the same. And they should be executed the same way. And then in the process, to be there, the understanding of the board of what we expect from these employees should be the same. And it's only fair to the employee. It's only fair to Bev that she knows what we're going to come back in March of next year or February next year and measure her against. She doesn't know that. We didn't know that we needed to do it.
I don't disagree with anything you were saying. Where my understanding was we already were in the early stages of a ballot scorecard process. We haven't gotten through that. I share your view because I've worked with these guys on that ballot scorecard, at least conceptually. I think we're moving in the right direction. I think, quite frankly, most everything that I'm hearing today is going to be addressed through that process. Could we be better? Not that I have any issue with your contract renewing, but I didn't know either that it had already auto-renewed. That would have been information I think should have been forthcoming. I didn't know, not that it changes anything, but regardless, how can we be better? I'm all for much more time on this. No argument.
So, to Chair, I ask that you reconsider a future special board meeting for a workshop to help us, give us an opportunity as a board to define the process that we want to follow. At the same time, dedicate a significant portion of that time to help identify how we're going to evaluate Bev. I think it should be done quickly. It's only fair to her because her contract's 6 months, that's 4 or 5 months in at this point. And I think we should spell out how we're going to evaluate her so that she knows at the end of the year what's expected of her. So I would like to schedule that June or July, and let's get going on this stuff and let's get it done.
My suggestion would be that we separate those two issues. I think we have a meeting to discuss Bev and whatever performance measures and requirements as it relates to those terms in her contract. As it relates to process, I would have no argument. Commissioner Wong, come back. Just why don't you make a proposal on what you think the process should be, what the timeline should be, and let's actually be looking at something that you feel addresses the concerns that you have, and then we can vet each and every element of that.
Well, I think that should be a board.
It will be.
Look, I can give you my suggestions, but I'm one person out of five. I think the board should have significant input into establishing what we expect, because I think we're not going to get there. And it would be a waste of time for us to come up with this five different ways. I think we should sit down for an hour or 2 hours and work through this. I think we do it as a group. This is our responsibility. I'm happy to do it, but I don't think that's the proper approach. This is not a one-person team. This is a five-person team. This is important.
I'm not one of suggesting that it would be a rubber stamp for the board, Steve. I'm talking about is having something that reads to what it is that you feel would be a solid process.
I'm happy to do it. But again, I still think we schedule the meeting and hash this out. I think Commissioner Berry's got a lot of experience in this area. I think he could be very helpful. Commissioner Gregoire could be very helpful.
I'm not circumventing a board meeting. I'm just saying, let's react to something and be able to discuss those specific issues instead of spending an hour kind of being nebulous. I'd rather be reacting to something specific.
Commissioner, maybe it would be helpful for you just to put the categories of the issues that the board would address.
That's fine. I'm happy to do it.
And that these are the things that the board decides as a whole. But you maybe list the categories of the issues versus coming up with the whole plan, which I agree is one person acting. Maybe you can just come up that the board can be thinking about the ideas in the process.
Happy to provide that.
As opposed to coming up with the process
yourself.
What's
the proper process for doing that? If I create what I think is an outline, what's the proper process for me as a board member to submit that to the who does that go to?
It would be part of the agenda and the backup documents, which we're hoping will be posted online 7 days before, and would go to all the board members and the public.
Okay,
bullet point type thing.
You got it. I'll do it.
And then everybody can see it at once.
So essentially we go to Patricia for inclusion on the agenda.
Right, as an attachment, as a backup supporting, just like we do the board books. But we're hoping to have it posted online soon. And
right.
If not publicly available, it would be a public document.
So I think that what we've come around to is that we need to spend some time with some housekeeping, with procedures and with loose ends that have been left over from prior matters. And I don't disagree. I mean, one thing I've identified in a few weeks that I've been chair now is there are things that need to be fixed. There's items to be cleaned up, and I think Commissioner Wellens, you've put your finger on a number of them. And one of them, as I referenced earlier, is resources. And I think that as a board, we need to retain counsel to give us guidance on appropriate employment contracts, particularly for those who are direct reports, and it can assist us in developing an appropriate contract template and to assist us in the negotiation of those employment agreements as we go forward with the direct reports on a consistent basis. And they can also, Commissioner Berry, keep track of deadlines for contract renewals and negotiation periods. That's what council do. And we need to have that, particularly as board members change from year to year, oftentimes. So if none of us were here when a certain contract was executed, we wouldn't have necessarily in our calendaring system when a contract would renew or when a certain date is significant. And I think we need to have someone who keeps track of that for the board. At the same time, we need to make sure that we have dedicated resources to help us put together the agendas and the books and the materials that are done. And we have that, but we need to make sure that person is dedicated to us and perhaps even additional resources to make sure that, again, things are done in an orderly fashion, because we're not going to tolerate matters being presented to the board last minute. Obviously, this being the first board meeting since the changeover, there were some things that were moved around on the agenda or added to the agenda, and we want to avoid that going forward. We want to have an agenda that is established and the materials that support each of those items presented in advance so that there's sufficient time for each of the members to review those items and ask the appropriate questions or get briefed as necessary. So there are certainly items that are already in process to be fixed going forward. These are a couple of items that we've now added to the list. And thank you for raising them, because they are items that do need to be addressed. So I guess the suggestion I've heard is that we establish one meeting or two meetings or workshops to address two separate items. I happen to agree that those are items that should be considered. To me, I think they should be considered separately, as I think you mentioned, Commissioner Urie. One is the contract process and how we want to proceed with that going forward. And what the process should be versus what it is today or yesterday, and what resources we need to accomplish our mission in that respect, and what input we need. And as part of that process, it may be more than just legal counsel. It may be outside consultants on various topics relative to metrics or salary and compensation and incentive plans. Because as I've said before, I think incentive plans are something that I think that we should have more of rather than less of within our system. Because we know where we are today, we know where we were recently, we know where we want to be tomorrow. And to get there, we need to incentivize people and retain the correct people as well. And obviously, Peter, you've hired a lot of nurses, and that's a step in the right direction. We've obviously talked a lot about creating incentive plans with balanced scorecards. We cover a lot of different topics, and I think that's, again, another step in the right direction. There's a lot of work that still needs to be done there, but we're getting there in terms of developing that those metrics and those targets. The other item, is related to that is the performance measures upon which our CEO will be measured pursuant to her contract. And I think it makes sense to start scoping those out as a separate item so that when we get there, there's at least some criteria upon which the board is acting at the appropriate time, saying these are the criteria we laid out, and they've either been met or not met, and we're going to deliberate and vote accordingly. The question I have is whether we can do that attended to a board meeting. I think given our the difficulty we have getting everyone together in the same room, we could perhaps have the workshop preceding a board meeting, our monthly board meeting, or following a monthly board meeting. Is that something that the people feel is appropriate, or that we need to schedule on a separate date?
I agree with you, Sam. Yeah. The sooner the better, especially as it relates to her performance measurements.
I think it's fine doing it the day of a board meeting.
Well, I don't have any issue with that either.
Before or after, it's irrelevant the timing of it. I just think it's what we should be doing. Bev has a series of obligations to us. She reports to us. We have a series of obligations to Bev, to give her guidance, to tell her what's expected, to lay out the general framework of how this district should be, we want it to operate, not how they want it. It's what we expect, what we're being held against. And I think we need to clarify that, and I think we need to define it, and I think we need to quantify it so that Bev knows that what she has to do for the next 6 or 7 months before this first contract year is over. I think every employee is entitled to that. And we failed to have given
time?
I apologize, just technically, so you're saying it's going to be part of the board meeting, or you're going to have a special board meeting?
Be a special board.
A special board meeting.
So we'll conclude our board meeting, and then we'll have a special board meeting in the nature of a workshop to consider the performance measurements intended to the CEO contract.
And who will be communicating to us what outside tool that you guys need for that board meeting?
That would be me.
Okay.
I'll take that responsibility.
Okay.
Outside tools? For what?
Consultants, attorneys, anything to be able to make a more decision. Chair.
Okay. And then at a subsequent date, we'll have a separate special board meeting in the nature of a workshop to address contract processes and the contract flow, creation of templates, et cetera.
That's fine. Do that in July. Yeah, that's fine with me. I'll get working on that. And we still need to work on the other workshop as well, so we'll do that. Look at your calendars if you don't know. I just think...
When do we want to fit that in? I mean, why don't we address that now since we're calendaring our items in?
Aren't you out of the country?
Right, for 2 weeks.
Where do you live?
Wednesday, a week from today, 6th to the 20th.
Go to the 10th.
10th is a Sunday, and I'll be flying out myself.
Why don't we do that? We're doing July, before the July board meeting.
Do one before, one after?
The process could wait to even probably to August if we don't have another contract that we're negotiating, right?
That's a good point. So,
is there any question?
Yeah.
Thanks.
All right, so why don't we push the contract process special board meeting until August and address the other workshop in July. Attend it to the July board meeting.
The performance one.
Okay. All right. Is there anything further on that item?
I think we've had it pretty exhaustively.
Okay. We'll just allow a minute or two for any commissioner comments and last minute comments commissioners have. Start with Commissioner Berry.
I just want to thank you guys for welcoming me and letting me see how the process works. I really want to thank the staff for the last 2 weeks of super soaker training. An hour a day bothering them, asking them questions, reading things that I probably didn't understand, then asking them follow-up questions. And they were very patient with me, and I appreciate it. So I want to say thank you to the staff for helping me out. And I'm looking forward to making this a place where anybody who needs health care in Broward County wants to stay. Just like the South Broward District says, no one should have to leave Broward County. We're the other half of that. We need to make sure everyone needs to leave our district to get their health care.
I would just like to emphasize again to them, it's nothing personal about Disney. We think you're wonderful. We want you exactly where we have you, and we're glad you're here. But we really did fail in our obligations as stewards of Broward's money.
Commissioner Wells,
Commissioner Brickwork said kind of what I was thinking. This stuff's not personal to me, but could you take it personal? It's not. And if you remember, I was a huge supporter of you from the day when we in this role, and I thought we had the right person when we put you in there. And I think you're the right person to lead this organization. But these are issues that are bigger than the one person. These are process-oriented, so I hope you don't take it personally, but
lot. And I think that as we sit here, we know we're heading in the right direction. We're getting a lot of good results, but it doesn't necessarily mean that the process is as smooth as it needs to be. And that's what we're talking about here, is continuing to get the right results, but through better mechanisms and more procedure and more appropriate time for review. So again, I think that, you know, our quality, our finances, and on so many measures, we continue to improve. Let's continue that, but at the same time, let's get to a smoother procedures and more transparency to the public, so that the public's even more aware of what we're doing in advance of our meetings to the extent possible. And certainly, part of that is also enhancing our communications, which is a work in progress as well. So there are things that we're working on day in and day out, and we look forward to continuing to deliver great results. Thank you all.
Right. Happy birthday.
Thank you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Well, thank you. Motion to adjourn.